Nah, Aaron, you actually might be able to guess what Emmy's doing. Ah, see, this is why I wait until about 5 after, because you never know what people's clocks are like, and there might be a Jeremy coming in. Probably, Aaron, probably. All right, Jeremy's here. It is 7:05. Thank you, Aaron. I really appreciate that. Are we live yet, Doug? Oh, good. Well, as we gather together, there is some technical information that most of you already know, but just in case someone does not, there is a copy of the service in the red book next to the door to the sanctuary. The service will be in voice and text. Worship music will be in the media player. And thank you for not touching the media player. We have learned the hard way that if you poke it, it gets cranky, and the video stops playing for everyone. So, if the player isn't working in your viewer, please follow the YouTube link. If you have a question about the United Church of Christ, or want to read scripture in worship, or have any questions about the group or our tags, or if you want to become a voting member of the church, please be in touch with any minister or staff member. And don't forget to explore this place. There is a lot here, including, as I understand it, an orca named Samson who you are now able to ride. So have fun with that. There are several points in today's scripture where a man finds himself in the odd situation of having to argue that he is, in fact, who he is. So does Nathan, actor Nathan Fillion in this scene from The Big Bang Theory.
Hi, we're here to pick up an order for a comic center.
Sure, let me go check on that.
Dude, I think that's Nathan Fillion.
Yeah, look at that.
And he's picking the tomatoes out of his salad just like I do.
I always did feel a connection with him. Oh, I have got an idea.
We're not selling his tomatoes on eBay.
No. If we got Captain Reynolds from Firefly to do a signing at Stewart's store, that would be amazing.
That would be great.
So should we go talk to him?
I don't know. If he's not nice, it's gonna make it hard for me to watch him in anything again.
What? The guy who plays Jon Snow was a jerk. We still watch Game of Thrones.
He was a jerk because you rear-ended him.
I was distracted. It's weird seeing a member of the Night's Watch with a kayak strapped to his car. Come on. Hi. Excuse me. So, I don't mean to bother you, but we're big fans of Firefly and Dr. Horrible.
Oh, I think you made a mistake. I'm not an actor.
But don't say that. I mean, you're not Dame Judi Dench, but you're pretty great.
Oh, yeah, I get it. You think I'm Nathan Fillion, but I'm not. So if you don't mind, I would just love to eat my lunch.
Come on. Sorry to bother you.
Don't know why he's so grumpy. I got mistaken for that guy in Life of Pi once. I'm still floating.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Sorry again.
No problem.
Are you sure you're not him? You can tell us. We're scientists, not crazy fanboys.
All right, fine. I'm him.
And you're eating alone at a deli. I don't buy it. You're not him.
Look, I just wanted to eat my lunch in peace, but I really am him. And thank you very much for being a fan. If you want, let's take a picture.
That would be great. Yeah, great. Thank you.
Wait, hang on. If you're really Nathan Fillion, what's the line from Firefly about your bonnet?
I swear by my pretty floral bonnet, I will end you.
That's it. That's the line.
Although, well, I knew the line doesn't make me Nathan Fillion.
Do you want the picture or not?
I want a picture with Nathan Fillion.
How about a picture with a guy who looks like Nathan Fillion, but a little more annoyed than Nathan Fillion usually is?
What do you think?
That's good enough for Facebook.
Well, welcome, everyone. Welcome to First United Church of Christ and Conference Center Second Life. We have official standing with the Eastern Association of the Southern California Nevada Conference of the United Church of Christ as a real life church located in Second Life. And I still think that's pretty cool because I have sat in South Central Pennsylvania, I have sat in Northern Maine, and I am currently sitting in Southeastern Connecticut. And I still think it's pretty cool that we can partner with my brothers and sisters all across the country and all of you, wherever you are. Speaking of wherever you are, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Because we are connected to the wider church and the world, we support the wonderful work of the UCC financially, as do all our churches. If you would like to help our ministry, there is a donation bowl at the rear of the sanctuary. If there's a donation you would rather make in real-life currency, you are welcome to use the donation page on our website. And since we are an IRS 501c3 public charity, U.S. donations are deductible. We thank you. Speaking of supporting the work of the wider church, there is a special offering bowl up front with me today. Any donation that goes into that bowl will go to the special offering known as One Great Hour of Sharing. I couldn't possibly tell you about all of the great things that are accomplished in the world through this special offering, but they range from disaster relief to, well, this kind of thing.
Imagine a seedling provided by your gifts to One Great Hour of Sharing, that with God's help can provide food, not just for a family, but an entire village, a village that can grow an economy, that provides opportunities that did not exist before, opportunities for thriving markets, for employments, for education, and even having a voice in government, opportunities that create a ripple of change, bringing hope to other villages, regions, and even entire countries. God can take our gifts to One Great Hour of Sharing and do more than we can imagine.
Thank you all so very much for your generosity. If you want to know more, you can always go to ucc.org/OGHS, that would be for One Great Hour of Sharing, and dig through the wealth of information that is there. I'm sorry, I don't know how much of that is coming through the mic there. To read scripture today, we have Joyous. Thank you so much for sharing your voice. Joyous.
Got a nice long one here. All right, so this is from John chapter 9. As he walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's work might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Isn't this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it's someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "How were your eyes opened?" He answered, "A man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' And I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. That was the seventh day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not for God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" They were divided. They said to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe he had been blind and received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked him, "Is this your son who you say was born blind? How then does he see?" Parents answered, "We know that this is our son and that he was born blind, but we do not know how it is that he sees, nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him. He's of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that anyone who confessed Jesus to be the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. Therefore, his parents said, "He is of age. Ask him." So for the second time they called the man who had been blind. They said to him, "Give glory to God. We know that this man is a sinner." He answered, "I do not know whether he's a sinner. One thing I do know, though I was blind, now I see." They said to him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered them, "I have told you already, and you would not listen. Or do you want to hear it again? Do you also want to become his disciples?" Then they reviled him, saying, "You are his disciple, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." The man answered, "Here is an astonishing thing. You do not know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but he does listen to one who worships him and obeys his will. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a person born blind. This man were not from God, he could do nothing." They answered him, "You were born entirely in sins, and are you trying to teach us?" So they drove him out. Jesus heard they had driven him out, and he found him and said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" He answered, "And who is he, sir? Tell me, so that I may believe in him." Jesus said to him, "You have seen him, and the one speaking with you is he." And he said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. Jesus said, "I came into this world for judgment, so that those who do not see may see, and those who do see may become blind." So the Pharisees near him heard him say this, said to him, "Surely we are not blind, are we?" Jesus said to them, "If you were blind, you would not have sin. But now that you say, 'We see,' your sin remains." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. And thank you so much, Joyous. That is a rather long lesson, and you did very well with it. Thank you very much. For those of you who have been with me for a long time, it shouldn't come as a surprise that this story always brings to mind an old friend of mine named Rebecca. And when I say old friend, I mean that I first met her when she was a teenager. She attended a creative writing conference for high school youth that Emmy and I co-led before we were married. Teenage Becca was an amazing musician and creative writer, and she certainly hasn't gotten any less amazing. She is currently working on her master's degree at Union Seminary and is already heavily involved in the UCC's disability ministries. In fact, our very own Marie heard Becca speak at General Synod last summer. Oh, did I forget to mention? My partner Emmy was Becca's babysitter from the time Becca was born. So they were there when she was born with retinoblastoma. Emmy was a part of Becca's life when she went blind at the age of 14 months. Years and years ago, I wrote a blog entry about this story, connecting it to a character from Star Trek The Next Generation named Geordi LaForge. LaForge was also born blind, but he had the advantage of living in the 24th century, and so he was fitted with a visor which allows him to see in the infrared and ultraviolet ranges and beyond. He's also very intelligent, and by the end of the series, he'd risen to the rank of lieutenant commander and was the chief engineer of the Enterprise. I still see some parallels between the way the man born blind talks circles around the religious authorities and the high intelligence of the Star Trek character who most people remember as that guy with the visor. Both the man in the gospel story and the character of Lieutenant Commander LaForge are much, much more than how much they can or cannot physically see. But in the blog entry, I landed in this place. I don't know firsthand what it's like to be blind, but I absolutely adore the story of the man born blind talking circles around his betters. And I've always loved the way Lieutenant Commander LaForge was the blind man who could see so much more than his compatriots. And then I linked it to Becca to see what she thought. And I love her for telling me the truth. That she thought that the image of the blind man who sees so much more than his compatriots is a sighted person's metaphor. And she's right. Of course she is. That's why I asked for her opinion. I knew that I had no idea what it's like. How could I? Years later, Becca handed me one of, if not the best sermons I've ever read concerning this story. And one of the points she makes in that sermon that has absolutely stayed with me is essentially this. If we were each created in God's image, and we are loved by God just as we are, then that includes a blind Becca. Becca is perfect just the way she is. She does not need fixed. The other piece that stuck with me was the idea that you had better ask for permission before you try to smear spit mud in her eyes. Ick. Exactly. In all honesty, I think I'll always have Becca in my mind whenever I read this story. Not because she is blind, but because she so thoroughly challenged my understanding of this story. And because she and I have struggled with it together. I think it's good to struggle with Scripture. To wrestle with it. I pray that this match honors both God and my friend. One of the great psychological truths that I learned in seminary is that change always involves loss, and that loss always requires mourning. That's an important thing to say, and I want to say it without tripping up, so I'm going to do it one more time. Change always involves loss, and that loss always requires mourning. And this is the part that always trips people up. Even positive changes. This is why weddings are so frequently way, way more stressful than people expect them to be. You've heard the old chestnut. I'm not losing a daughter, I'm gaining a son. To quote Colonel Sherman T. Potter, horse hockey! A wedding changes not one family, but two. And it is absolutely no wonder that someone is going to kind of lose their mind about it. And so I find that the real miracle in this story is that the person who has lost the most presents as the most stable. First of all, the gospel writer doesn't give the protagonist of this story a name. So, the man born blind, right off the bat, has his name taken away. He is only known by one aspect of his identity, the blind man. And then, without even asking, Jesus takes that piece of his identity away. He is no longer the blind man. And he is put in a really weird social situation where everyone around him is questioning who he is. Isn't that the guy that was born blind? It is. No, it's someone that looks like him. Are you you? I am. No way. But he takes it in stride. And I think that's pretty amazing. He certainly responds better than the Pharisees did. And again, it is always worth pointing out that when the gospel writer refers to the Jews, what they mean is the religious authorities, not the entire people. The Pharisees completely lose their cool because his loss of identity threatens their faith, which revolves around a specific interpretation of the Mosaic law. The problem is that this all happened on the Sabbath. And miraculous healing is work. And you can't work on the Sabbath. So, you absolutely cannot claim that you've been blind from birth and got miraculously healed on the Sabbath, because miracles are of God, and God wouldn't break the rules like that. So there. The Pharisees were absolutely desperate to prove that he was lying, because they stood to lose a huge chunk of their religious identity. It's pretty similar to what happens when you suggest to a fundamentalist that not everything in the Bible makes logical sense. Removing one piece threatens the whole thing. So they try to back him into a corner. And he just runs rings around them. And they try to deny that he is who he says he is, or that he was born blind, by bringing his parents in to prove him wrong. And his parents basically said, we know that he's our son, and that he was born blind, but we don't know anything else. He's an adult. We aren't responsible for him. I don't know about you, but I would have felt thrown under the bus by my own parents. One more loss for the poor guy, apparently. In the end, rather than accept the change and the associated loss, the Pharisees run him out of the synagogue. Yet another loss. And yet, he keeps his cool. Unlike the Pharisees, who were too afraid in the face of change to reason, he keeps his cool. So when Jesus hears that he was run out of the synagogue and returns to check on him, and Jesus asks, do you believe in the Son of Man? He is able to respond reasonably. Well, tell me who he is, and I can tell you if I believe. And for once, Jesus jettisons the metaphor. It's me, dude. Do you believe in me? Oh, yes. Oh, yes, I believe. I have been wrestling with this story for years. maybe I always will. And I think that's a good thing, because the person who does the best in this story says over and over, I don't know. I don't understand it. I can only tell you what happened. And then, in the end, the people who said over and over, we know, we are certain, we have the only right interpretation, were wrong. That's what Jesus is really saying at the end of this story. It's when you say, we know, we are certain, we have the only right interpretation, that you are sinning. But what do I know? What do you say? Amen? I don't know either, V. I like to believe that the synagogue's wayward son found some kind of rest with Jesus thereafter. But really, I chose this next song because of the line, and if I claim to be a wise man, that surely means that I don't know.
Carry on my wayward son, there'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest, don't you cry no more. Thank you.
we have come to our time in worship that I really do believe is the core of what we do here together. And that is where we uplift our joys and concerns with one another in prayer. Please type those into chat. Or if you need to use voice, simply emote raising your hand so everybody can have a voice. And as we pray together, you may wish to respond to others with words like, God, hear our prayer, or with any other words the Spirit leads you to use. And maybe I'll start while you all are typing. I want to pray a prayer of thanksgiving for all of the people, you know, private and corporations and schools and whatever other kinds of folk you can think of who are helping to make the world a better place during the pandemic, during the spread of the coronavirus that we're trying to help stop. Politics aside, there are people who are stepping into the breach to help make things a little bit better. From entertainers to I heard a story about a bus driver who took it upon himself to bring a lunch to everybody on his school route so that kids wouldn't have to live without a lunch just because school wasn't in session. It's a beautiful thing. I'm kind of smiling and giggling a little bit too because that thing that happened at the very beginning of the worship service was Emmy letting me know that I just missed a previously unperformed song by Indigo Girls having a free live concert in their living room or in somebody's living room. They don't live together. We're pretty sure it's Amy's. Anyway, so that's why I was going, maybe I'll wait until later to let you know. I wanted you to go watch Indigo Girls instead of coming to worship. There's a lot of good out there as well as a lot of terrible, and just wanted to uplift that because I think it's easy to get lost in the haze. O God of good things, hear our prayers. With Chair, we pray because there's a situation that they find themselves in the middle of with no foreseeable way out. So we simply pray that the situation has a positive outcome. It sounds like a great deal of drama, Jeremy, and I'm really sorry that you find yourself in the middle of that. But I don't know exactly what it is, but I don't need to. God knows what's going on, and so we pray that the best that can be will be. O God, who helps us sort out our drama, hear our prayers. With Doug, we pray for all of those who are in need. Emmy, with an IE, that's not my Emmy. My Emmy has an I and stops there. But for our Emmy and Marie and Laura and Butterfly and Fen and anybody else we missed who are in need, we pray. O God of us all and God of healing, hear our prayers. Yes, thank you, Johnny. We need to pray for everyone's health at this time and relief for people who are suffering. And for people who are scary and worried, they may find some peace in God during this time. I cannot say it any better than that. And so I will simply say, Amen. Oh, Yachty. Okay. I was having an email with Yachty today, and they didn't mention that they're sick. We were trying to find a time to have a conversation, but gosh, it can wait until they're not full of bronchitis. Goodness. We pray for Yachty that God's healing presence may be upon them. O God of healing, hear our prayers. With Cleo, we pray for all of the planet and billions of humans, animals, and plants, we may all be safe and happy. And we also pray for the good bacteria that lives in your guts. I love that prayer. Oh, God of creation, hear our prayers. Oh, Johnny, we pray that he might get out of the clinic one way or another, as Johnny can't have any visitors, can only see family via Skype. You say one way or the other, I'm going to dare to pray that it be because your weight goes up to where it should be. We want you to be healthy. We just do. But we pray that you are able to go back to family. You won't be able to get any visitors there either until things have calmed down with the pandemic, I imagine. But to be separated from family is difficult in certain times. So we pray that you be able to do that because you're healthy. Oh, God of family and healing, hear our prayers. And with Monica, we go ahead and universalize all of that. We pray for peace in the midst of so much trouble. Oh, Prince of Peace, hear our prayers. With Fee, we pray for friends locked down in their nursing homes and assisted living centers. Yeah, and you're praying for those in your community. I'm going to go ahead and universalize that to all folk who are in nursing homes and assisted living centers and unable to have the visitors that social creatures like human beings need to have. Oh, God of most vulnerable, hear our prayers. With Jeremy, we pray that stress levels can be controlled. I can't say it any better than that. Oh, God of relief, hear our prayers. Oh, with Johnny, we pray for all those people who are flooding back into Second Life for comfort and for connections, that we can all be there to help them and do what God made us for. What a beautiful prayer. Oh, God who makes us all ministers, hear our prayers. And with Doug, we are thankful for new friends who find us here. I think Doug may have had someone specific in mind, but I like that we universalized it. So for whoever was in Doug's mind, and for any other new friends we may find here, O God of community, hear our prayers. Oh, Jeremy, we pray that Lily's team keeps earning money for the ACS. At the rate she's going, she'll break last year's total. Well, congratulations to Lily a little bit ahead of time. We pray that that she be able to break that total. Oh, God of charity, hear our prayers. Oh, that's a blessing, Chris. I'm glad to hear that. You're welcome, Cleo. I'm not touching that one, but I did have a good giggle. Thank you for that. Oh, yes, with Jose, we pray for the many people who have lost their jobs due to the pandemic. We have been bringing in money primarily through Emmy, who has been helping take care of people's dogs while they do things like go to work or go on vacation. And a lot of those things aren't happening. And so we are among the underemployed. And there are many more people who are simply sitting at home, not on a salary, and not making any money because they can't go to work. And so we pray that there be some sort of financial relief for people who have had their lives so heavily impacted by the pandemic. Oh God, oh sustaining God, hear our prayers. Well, that's a good thought too, Doug. I hope that, what I said included those folk. Ooh, that was a bunch. Did I miss any of them? Looks like Aaron might be typing. Nothing from those watching on Facebook. Thank you. Thank you, thank you. Oh, I do my best. Thank you for saying that. That's a nice compliment. Well, speaking of unspoken prayers, if there was one inside of you that you couldn't quite get out, it's okay. Because the psalmist tells us that God knows what we are going to say before the words can even form on our tongues. And so we know. We know that God has heard our prayers, those spoken out loud, those typed into Second Life chat, and those spoken only in the silence of our hearts, and that we pray them in the name of the Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. We have done a lot of talking. Let us take a moment of silence to listen to what God might be saying. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. Creator of us all, whether we are from China or Italy or the United States, we are one people made in your image, and we are in need of healing. Bind us together, great Creator, reminding us that we are from the same stardust. Call us into the work of love for one another. Help us to denounce racism, to call out prejudice when we perceive it, and to work for justice. We are all your children. Help us to view one another as siblings, bound together in love. In the name of Christ, in whom we all have the name children of the living God, we pray. Amen. And now it really is just this simple. God loves you, so don't forget to love each other. Go with God, go in peace, and amen. You're welcome. I may be dating myself just a little bit here, but I have a strong memory of running across this music video on MTV and being absolutely entranced by the visual representation of an epiphany, a moment where someone's outlook literally changed, Watch closely. See how you feel about the eye-opening experience in this piece.
All the words that I've been reading have now started the act of